from my perspective, breast cancer has been a fatal thing in my family. That's been the thing that so many women have died from on my mother's side of the family. I get screened every 6 months. I go between mammograms and ultrasounds and MRIs and doctor's visits. I'm biopsied all the time and, you know, you don't know the results for days. So you sort of put in this very vulnerable position of, is it this time? Is it this time? Stop for further, please.
The world knows, you know, Erica as, you know, being married to James Packer and mother to his three children, a beautiful model. But she certainly doesn't want to be in the spotlight. I mean, that's just not her.
So down here was like our local shops and stuff. I mean, these shops are all new.
Erie's not a very public person. I think we want to do this program just because our family has quite a big history of breast cancer. There is that cloud sort of hanging over the family, you know, with so much history.
There are a lot of families like Joe and Erica's which have a strong family history of breast cancer, but they actually don't know the genetic cause of that breast cancer.
I'd love the answers. I'd love to know if I'm a carrier, if my brother's a carrier, if that goes into the next generation and how we confront that. I feel very passionate about it because there's 100,000 Aussies in the same boat that I'm in. It's a medical mystery that we're really hoping to uncover.
All right, I'm just going to get all the kids to sort of arrange in a pyramid.
Joey, our brother Billy, and I have always, since we were kids, been very close and been very good friends.
All right, I want a happy one from everyone on the count of three. One, two, three.
Billy has three children and Erie has three children and I have four children and they all just love each other like crazy.
Erica and Joe's family, they've got multiple members that have been diagnosed with breast cancer in different generations that are very closely related.
Oh, cheers, everyone. So nice having everyone.
Cheers. Yes, thank you.
Mum was diagnosed 25 years ago. Joe had breast cancer at 39 and survived.
Berlin Wall, yay or nay?
They found it early enough, and that's why we get to sit here.
Yeah.
And, you know, do this.
But we haven't found the cause of it yet, or a gene that links us all together.
He's 50.
Is he
that?
He's 50.
He's 27.
I'm not 50.
He's in his 50th year, Michael.
Yeah, he's 50.
You'd be lucky to make 50. All the cancer in this family, you'll be dead by 66.
In the mid-90s, we first discovered two of the major breast cancer genes that seem to be inherited in families. And what we're learning is that there are more genes that are associated with developing breast cancer. We've coined the term called missing matches to try and identify in those families what that genetic error is and what that gene is that's being passed down through the family.
Now let's have a look. All these instructions, I hope I can follow them. Okay, so it actually looks quite easy. Because I've had breast cancer, I'm actually in the process of getting genetic testing. Look at then, I just have to fill up the vial up to here with saliva, spitting it in, which I don't think I'll be showing.
You don't want to do that on national TV?
No. I want to get tested to see if we have one of the genes that they have found since I have diagnosed 12 years ago.
My lovely saliva. Yep. And then, thank goodness I've got steady hands.
All nursing skills coming back to play.
All my nursing skills. Use the cap tightly and then you have to shake for 5 seconds.
I would like to get some answers for ourselves, for our generation and for the generation below us.
Right, we're doing well. And then I'm going to put it back in the box and then I'm going to send it off and wait for the results for a couple of weeks.
God, it feels amazing to be back. It's like
it's very green. It's
warm
lovely.
Hug.
Yeah.
Oh,
There's KFC. Do you remember when that came into town?
And it was so exciting.
Actually massive news. Okay, we had nothing. We used to have to... There's only fish and chips at the local cafe.
I feel really grateful to have grown up in Gunnedah. It's such a beautiful little country town.
The main street.
Wow.
Hasn't changed
this
much.
It is amazing.
Mum and Dad really created a very strong, solid base for all of us as kids.
Oh, and then we come down. Oh my gosh, the tennis courts always seem so many.
Tennis courts, major part of our lives growing up.
Yeah. There's the athletics field. So, so fun. Put in many an hour there.
I'm the eldest, and then there's my brother, and then Gary, who is quite a bit younger than me. You wouldn't be able to tell, but 5.5 years, yeah, younger.
God, it's so nice to be back.
I know.
Mum and Dad were happily married for 41 years, so, you know, I just think they've instilled in us this great family bond that we have.
Dad's office, WA Baxter & Co. God, we used to spend so much time here as kids. My dad was a solicitor in town, and his father was before him. Mum was a nurse, and she was very no-nonsense. Like, if you weren't broken and you weren't, you know, dying of a fever, you were at school, you had, you know, you had to always sort of get on with it, that good sort of rural Aussie mum. I think Mum really encouraged us to get out and try everything, and maybe it was just to get us out of the house. we all played a lot of sport. It was nice. I went to boarding school for year 7, and then when I was 15, I was scouted on a North Sydney train station, much to my embarrassment. It was a woman from Priscilla's. So I went in to see them, and she's still my agent today.
My first impressions of Erica was, wow, what a bubbly, gorgeous, vivacious kid. She was probably, you know, a little bit too young, but she was always wise beyond her years. She's a very, very bright person, and she really took to modelling like a duck to water.
When I was about 16 and a half, I left school and I went to Milan and sort of started modelling there. My dad never wanted me to leave school. He was very against it and sort of slightly heartbroken. But my mum was just like, this is an amazing opportunity and go see the world and, you know, school, you can always go back to school. I think after 3 days in Milan, I was calling Priscilla going, please send me home. I want to be back with my parents. You know, as a little kid from Gunnedah, you know, I was going off to Africa doing a shoot and Cuba, all these, Jamaica, and it was really a wild time. If it was my children, there'd be no way. No chance. But, you know, it was a different time.
Erica had high-profile boyfriends along the way, especially her first boyfriend, really, of that ilk, was Jason Donovan. And with Jason, who was very famous at the time, came all that media scrutiny. But Erica just coped with it extremely well.
I do remember in London with Jason once, one of the first things we went to was a party for Elton John, and going into this massive party. Everywhere I went, everyone was faint. And I just thought, wow, this is a whole new level of, like, nothing I've ever seen.
While Erie was working around the world, I became a registered nurse and worked at North Shore Hospital, and then met my husband David there, who was a doctor, and worst cliche in the whole world.
But playing doctors and nurses.
Yeah, we didn't play doctors and nurses at all, but it was certainly, I met the day I met him, I knew I was going to marry him.
And I just saw this beautiful, you know, intelligent, vivacious young girl, and I thought, amazing. And we started having kids when we were pretty young.
Erica and Joe were both living in London in 1999 when they got the news that their mother, Sheila, had breast cancer.
Mum was diagnosed when she was 54 years old, so she was still quite young.
She had a mastectomy and then went straight into chemo for 9 months. And then after that, she had radiation therapy for a long time. She was really no nonsense about it. She obviously must have been terrified, but didn't sort of show that.
When Mum was diagnosed, there was such a large number of family members that had had it as well. It was kind of like, oh, there's something going on here. Yeah, this isn't normal.
So if we have me, start with you. As the index person, the first person of this generation, we can get tested.
I think every woman on my mother's side has had breast cancer.
Oh, you need to underline. So underline.
Oh, sorry.
Breast cancer.
Yep.
Oh, right, well done. Okay. And then we have Mum with beautiful hair and her sister, Marion.
My mum's sister had breast cancer. My mum's mum had breast cancer. And then with my mum's generation, there's 18 of our 21 relatives that had cancer.
We don't know exactly all the names, but of that generation, there was around 14 of those had breast cancer.
And so that makes it a significant hereditary risk.
Mum did have genetic testing back then, but it didn't show anything.
Mum didn't have the mutation in the BRCA1 and 2 genes. These are the two known gene mutations that put you at higher risk of breast cancer.
And so then, at that time, they said there's no real point in the rest of us getting genetic testing. If she doesn't carry it, then we won't carry it.
There's three or four little girls in the next generation that it'd be handy for them to know what's going on.
Yeah.
We didn't know then that there were a number of other gene mutations out there that could cause breast cancer.
Yeah.
Mum definitely didn't want us to stop our life and go home. She goes, I don't want you to come home and I'm not dying. Like, I'm not going to die. Don't come home and make me feel like I'm dying.
It didn't surprise me really when Ari went into a music career after all the hairbrushes and the dancing around the rumpus room non-stop.
I had the best time, and being in the studio writing songs and just coming up with things each day. But I didn't love the performing side of it. I used to get really anxious and whatever. I'd be sort of throwing up backstage and think, and I just thought, I can't. It's as much as I love it and as much as I want to do it, that constant feeling was pretty rough. And it was also a time in my life, you know, when James and I were dating, not that I had to choose and he never asked me to choose ever, but I think I thought, I'd rather focus on this than that.
Erica and James started dating in 2002. They had been friends prior to a romantic relationship starting between them.
In 2005, James Packer inherited the family's multi-billion dollar media empire when his father, Kerry, died.
He's so clever. And he was so funny and charming and very dynamic. And it's a very big life with James. You know, getting to meet all these world leaders and fascinating people, these big brains and people that are changing the world, that I felt very privileged to be a part of.
Erica and James got married in the south of France in 2007. And it was, yeah, it was an incredible, you know, time. It was huge.
At my wedding, Mum had a lot of back pain and we just thought it was the travel. But, you know, and she wanted to be there for me and it was a big moment in my life.
I think she knew that the cancer had come back, but she didn't want it to sort of distract from the day. But after the wedding, then they realised that the cancer had come back and it had spread.
This is a nice one, Mum.
Dad's got his Boston Red Sox hat on. Good
work. Yeah, 2011 was a really tough year for our family. It just, you know, as that saying goes, when it rains, it pours, it sure poured.
Considering how good she looked compared to how she was actually feeling at the time.
I'd been screening for breast cancer since I was 35, and so I had a clear mammogram in July, and then by January I had three tumours in one of my breasts, so caught on an MRI.
She was only 39 years of age. We had four young kids, all of whom in a really formative part of their life, but all old enough to understand what cancer meant.
And then do you remember when I
the day of the surgery? You went to school? It was a long day.
I remember when I went to school, my friend came up to me and I had just found out, so it was still sensitive news, and she told me that my mum was going to die. It's a terrifying thing because it's your biggest support system. You're terrified the whole time until the end.
And they gave me the blue dye and I came out and I looked like an avatar. Into the dye?
You're very elder.
My sister is one of my best friends in the world, and watching her go into that operation and not knowing if her cancer had spread was pretty scary.
Because I had been so diligent with the screening, I just never believed for one minute that I was going to die or I was going to be really ill, that I just knew I'd be okay.
That early detection was fantastic for her. She didn't have to have chemotherapy, but she underwent bilateral mastectomy because just of this sort of high incidence.
After I had the mastectomy, I started the breast reconstruction process, and I was very happy with my reconstruction.
Jo's really helped a lot of people on their journey through breast cancer. You know, Jo is a nurse, like my mum was, and so they're carers.
When I met you, I had no idea, what this was going to be like.
Recently, I brought a friend called Manami to meet Jo. She'd been diagnosed with breast cancer.
Once you get diagnosed with breast cancer, you go into the breast cancer family.
It's a very unique connection.
It is.
It's not something
and
you want,
describe
but
it. Wrapped around you a little bit,
nice.
I think.
So Jo gave her great counsel and comfort and support.
And the double mastectomy and a reconstruction was something I was already thinking, so that's exactly what you did.
But you just don't know what you're dealing with. You don't expect it, and then you've got to learn really quickly.
You didn't. And I said to Manami, Jo, when she meets with women, she actually shows women what a reconstruction looks like.
When people were getting diagnosed and they were scared and facing a mastectomy and stuff, she would go around and basically show them her boobs and give them a peep show of like, look, they can still look great. It's going to be okay.
It was really helpful, for you to show your outcome.
I think there was a joke at one stage that there wasn't a person left in Sydney that hadn't seen my breasts.
I know, the peep show queen. Who knew?
It's been so long since I've been up here.
Yeah.
So beautiful.
It's actually quite green at the moment.
Yeah. Where's Mum and Dad's house?
As 2011 progressed, I had the all clear then. But back in Gunnedah, Mum was getting sicker and sicker.
Nana didn't want to give away too much, especially because we were young. So I didn't really know she was sick until a bit older, until it was a bit worse. Definitely the first time I saw her take her wig off was probably the first sign where I was like, oh, most people don't have that.
And then it started to spread everywhere. And then it was a case of chemo till she grew a tolerance to it, and then another chemo and another until she ran out of chemos.
Mum was very strong mentally, but about October, Mum was told that she had 6 to 8 weeks, there was nothing else they could do, and I'm not going to be able to do it, I don't think.
Towards the end, we made a decision to go away for a week, spend a week on a boat in Fiji with the whole family together, just so we could be together, because we knew that would probably be the last time.
As tough as that time was, I think we all feel really grateful that we could be there with her on the boat as she passed and holding her hand and giving her a lot of love. So that part of it I'm very grateful for. We started to support the breast cancer cause probably when Mum first got her prognosis. Going into all those chemo rooms and seeing all the patients and seeing what they go through and,
And how good the staff
everyone's
are.
So brave and the nurses and are so brave and friendly. And I think it really became part of our family, this disease.
Erica and Joe and their family represent many Australian families out there which do not have a known genetic cause for their breast cancer. We are funding the research at the Peter MacCallum Cancer Institute so we can continue to identify more of these genes, more of these missing matches that are causing breast cancer in these families.
The Familial Cancer Centre provides genetic testing, genetic counselling.
Going down to Melbourne and seeing the research centre actually got me really excited.
Thank you.
Even since I was tested 12 years ago, there's been huge medical advancement in genetic testing for breast cancer.
Come on in.
Thank you. Where would you like me to sit?
Just here's mine.
I'm going to have a consultation with one of the doctors here about genetic testing.
When I had genetic testing done 10 years ago, you know, after the diagnosis, to have the BRCA gene tested, and we did not have the BRCA gene in our family.
We have a lot of new information around the genetics involved in breast cancer, and of course that's changing all the time.
10 years ago we knew about BRCA1, BRCA2, and they are still the most important genes for breast cancer. But for people who were tested more than a decade ago, if they have a strong family history, there is a good reason to say, well, what more can we do?
Recently, the list of genes that can contribute to breast cancer has started to grow, and at the moment we can offer a test to people that has around 8 to 10 different genes that are involved in the risk of breast cancer.
If you don't find anything when you do the testing, what happens to that then?
We can take the same genetic sample that's provided up to the research laboratory and start looking further for things that we can't test for in the clinic.
Families that don't test positive for that panel of 8 to 10 breast cancer genes can be referred to Professor Ian Campbell's research study, which is trying to find those other breast cancer genes that may run in these families.
So what we've got here is one of our new DNA sequencing machines. This one can do 10 billion sequencing reads in an individual. So this machine here overnight could sequence your whole genome. So I could
take. We have a very large number of women who have been tested for all the known genes but have returned negative result. So those women have kindly given us permission to look deeply at the genes to see if we can find an explanation.
We will sequence that DNA and we'll look at a much bigger bank of genes to see if there's anything going on in those other genes.
So as part of our research, we found about 40 genes which look plausible that they might cause the breast cancer in those women. So Jo has had breast cancer, and if we can discover what gene is causing her breast cancer, that then allows us to start testing Erica and other family members and to see whether those other family members also carry that same gene mutation.
Houses are so beautiful around here.
Yeah.
Just all the colours.
Don't you think? I am getting tested every 6 months, and when you have to wait for those results, those days are harrowing. And it's sort of like last summer I had a pretty bad diagnosis, and I had something that had grown very quickly, very aggressively, that really sort of stopped us in our tracks a little bit. You know, you suddenly smacked in the face with your own mortality, and is this something or is it nothing at all? And it's something families like ours, they go through it every 6 months. Super
cute. We were just lucky that time for Airy that it was a false alarm.
For somebody like Erica, if we were able to offer a test that would be able to tell her about her future risk, then it would come with a range of options and recommendations about how we can manage that risk.
I think at the end of the day, knowledge is power. So without understanding the genetic cause of their breast cancer, people can't make fully informed decisions about their screening, about their prevention, or potentially if they develop breast cancer, about their future care.
I think this genetic testing is so important for that reason. Whether I do something with it or not, I have the information to make an informed decision on what to do with my body or what not to do with my body.
Yeah, I think, Airy, once we find out whether we've got a gene or not, Dan, I think we go from there. I'm still waiting on the results of my genetic testing.
I'm not sure when the time frame, but we're just waiting. And then I then make an appointment to speak to him.
At this stage, I would like to keep the results private just so we have a chance to sort of process them. I do feel slightly nervous about getting the results because there are big consequences for our family if we do find a gene.
James and Erica split in 2013, and subsequently Erica moved to Los Angeles with the children.
Yeah, we spent 9 years in LA to sort of give the kids a bit more of an upbringing away from the spotlight a little bit, especially with the scrutiny that went around James and my divorce.
She was intensely private, but she was very strong. She wasn't out there bad-mouthing anyone. She was just very dignified.
We had an 11-year relationship, but we still share such a respect for each other and care and a lot of love for each other. And out of that, we have these three beautiful children who are our absolute priority in our lives. You know, and everything I do now is for them and to try and create that sense of love and safety and security that I was fortunate to have as a kid.
Oh, lovely.
So much easier,
yeah,
because I can hide now.
And, you know, raise them to be capable young adults, and especially in the surrounds that they grow up, which is, you know, obviously different to me.
My baby's bigger than your baby.
Because I've been surrounded by breast cancer my whole life, I've always been fearful about me getting it. I think I'm too early now. I've thought about it, but I think it's too early now to go get screened, but I think I'll be screening from maybe 30 on. By early screening, I'll be able to catch it early.
I used to do cuarto, cuarto, octado, sedoro, which is 16. Okay. 16. And then a worldle.
There's a really funny
And now
thing.
You shower and brush your teeth and do other stuff.
Hopefully by the time that our daughters are coming of age, the doctors have solved all these problems and we've found every gene under the sun, and it won't be a problem for all families like ours out there that have a breast cancer familial gene. You know, mystery will be solved and, you know, we will eradicate deaths from breast cancer. That's my main hope in life for all of us, you know, for our family and for our daughters and for the next generation to come.